and thanks for having me, and thanks to you all for coming as well. Like Patricia said, I'm here studying at Princeton for most of this year. I'm doing my... Talk a bit louder. Just hand me out in this here. Okay, so I'm... So my PhD work is looking at the European Union from the perspective of democratic theory, particularly looking at also from the perspective of comparative federalism, looking at cases of Switzerland and Belgium as comparative cases for the EU. My home university is the European University Institute, which is in Florence, Italy, and it's kind of it's actually related somewhat to the European Union as a... Okay, so, well, glad to be here to talk to you about the European Union. And like I said, I work a little bit on this myself from the perspective of democratic theory and comparative federalism. And, well, I just wanted to start by changing the slide. That would be a good start. There we go. Okay, so, as I see it, there are five main areas of EU scholarship. First of all is European integration, which is, you know, it's largely the purview of historians, international relations scholars. They're looking at how the EU has developed, the causal mechanisms driving its development, and what are the future prospects for integration. Then you have the area of European politics, which is largely studied by political scientists. It looks at how the institutions are arranged, how the actors in the institutions engage with one another, and it also pays special attention to the democratic standards of the European Union. Then you have the area of European society, which is what sociologists are looking at, and they're basically trying to ask what are the social impacts of European integration on the member states. You have European law also, which looks at the treaty framework, it looks at the legislation produced by the European institutions. It also looks at the decisions made by the Court of Justice and its consequences for national legislation. Then you have European economy, looking at the economic performance of the member states, particularly concerned with the euro currency and also the activities of the European Central Bank. Now, and obviously all these areas overlap with one another, but I think most important to understand before you can understand anything else is European integration and European politics. And it's these two areas that we're going to focus on today, both because very important for understanding the basis of the EU, and also because they're closest to my area of interests. So we'll start with looking at European integration. It's obviously a long story, 60-year history. I'm just trying to give you the kind of the whistle-stop tour of European integration history. So I'll try to hit the main highlights. So as just generally speaking, you can distinguish between, I would say, three main periods of European integration. First of all, you have the launch period, 1951 to 57. Then after that, you have a period where it's kind of less intense than the launch period, but still some very significant developments taking place in this kind of gradualistic period of European integration is from 1958 to 85. And then from 1986 to the present, you have this period of a kind of a relaunch of the original project and the politicization of the European Union. So we'll start off with the launch period, and there I've just given you some images of two of the founding fathers. The European Union is Robert Schuman and Jean Monnet, both prominent French politicians. We'll see them come up a little later. Okay, so well, the story starts with the end of the Second World War, the aftermath of World War II, the widespread feeling we should never let such a catastrophe happen again, and that certain forms of cooperation are going to be required in order to prevent war again. So, you know, after World War II, you had all sorts of cooperation take place. You had military cooperation with NATO, you had human rights and democratic cooperation with the Council of Europe, with the United Nations, And then Europe was also a special case. And Winston Churchill was really one of the first, after the World, Second World War, one of the first and biggest figures to paint a vision for Europe that he called the United States of Europe. And he believed that the engine for this United States should be the two most powerful and historically hostile towards one another countries, France and Germany. And his formula was, cooperation wasn't enough. It was the kind of deep cooperation made possible by mutual dependence. That was the formula for securing peace in the long term. And it was the French the Commissioner General of the French National Planning Board, Jean Monnet, was the one who put meat on the bones of this very general vision painted by Churchill. And he decided in coming up with his plan for European integration was that European countries, France and Germany in particular, should integrate on coal and steel. And I think some of you probably know what the rationale might have been for this. Any ideas as to, why in particular integrate on coal and steel? And why not integrate on agriculture? Why not integrate on other commodities? What in particular was special, can you think, about coal and steel? Any ideas? Excellent, yeah. One big reason. Anything else? Yeah. Yeah, absolutely, exactly. So this is historically given as one of the biggest reasons. And there are also strong economic reasons too, that coal and steel themselves are going to be necessary for the rebuilding of Europe. They were key raw materials, and from a purely economic perspective, very important to the building of Europe. So there's going to be a lot of transactions, a lot of trade in these goods, and was going to be a very important thing to integrate upon. It was also important to have a strong Germany. It was thought as well. The economic potential of Germany was very clear. It also had a lot of these resources, and the view was a strong Germany was good for a strong Europe. So this is the rationale behind coal and steel. Very simple, but very smart. And this led to Robert Schuman, the French foreign minister at the time, in 1950, to announce what was going to be the European Coal and Steel Community. And he did this very much along the lines of the vision sketched by Churchill. He was talking about the Coal and Steel Community as a first step towards grander European integration in the long term. So this is what ultimately led to the Treaty of Paris in 1951, which established the European Coal and Steel Community, composed of members of West Germany, France, Italy, and the three Benelux countries. And it's worth noting, actually, the institutional structure of the coal and steel community, because it's very similar to what we find in the European Union today. So first you had the High Authority, which was this kind of independent body that was there to manage the coal and steel community, basically to implement the treaty on a daily basis. And that today is what we call the European Commission, is what it has evolved into. Then you have the Council of Ministers, which was a body designed to deal with daily affairs that weren't quite covered by the treaties. And these, it's so called because it was based on individuals drawn from ministerial positions from the government of the member states. And today, that's called the Council of the European Union. It's also still often called, commonly, the Council of Ministers, has retained its name in common usage. Then you also had the Assembly, which was kind of like the monitoring body or the watchdog of the coal and steel community. And this was composed of national parliamentarians. And today, this has evolved into what we now call the European Parliament. Then you had the Court of Justice, which was essentially the arbiter of any kind of problems that arose in the daily affairs of the coal and steel community would be dealt with by the Court of Justice. And today, this is the Court of Justice of the European Union. Okay, so that's the first part of the launch period, and in thinking about how integration has progressed since then, we should think in three main categories. The first way Europe has integrated is through policy area, by expanding its competences. Second way is by through a more powerful and complex institutional framework. The third way it is integrated is by expanding its membership, so constantly adding new members and becoming a bigger and more powerful union. But you know, I think most of you know that this hasn't been a very smooth process. It's proceeded by way of fits and starts, with some periods of very deep integration occurring and some periods with very little integration taking place. So, once with the success of the Paris Treaty, there was still a big appetite for integration, and it immediately led to plans for a European defence community and a European political community. And the European defence community is just like what it sounds. It was the integration of the militaries of the six member states. And the European political community was to be a kind of a democratic assembly designed to provide the foreign policy that would go with the defence community. There was a lot of support for this amongst the governments of the member states. The United States encouraged it very much so. They were interested in having a militarily strong Europe that could help combat the forward march of communism. And despite this positivity, the French Parliament, by, I don't know, about a 10-20% majority, rejected the European defence community out of concerns for national sovereignty. The argument was, if you give up your military power, if you integrate a military, how can you really be a sovereign state anymore? So that put an end to what would have been a big step in European integration. But you know, there was still a very strong desire for economic integration, even if not military integration. And this led in 1957 to the Treaties of Rome, which established the European Economic Community and the European Atomic Energy Community, or Euratom. So now we had three different communities. We had the Coal and Steel Community, European Economic Community, and Euratom. And they all had a different treaty basis, but they all had, and they all had different separate institutions to govern them, but the institutions had a very similar structure. There was the high authority, the Assembly, Council of Ministers, etc. The EEC, quickly, the European Economic Community, quickly became the most important. Its goal was essentially to establish the free movement of goods, free movement of persons, and the free movement of capital across the member states. And this has always been added to and built to this very day, but it largely hasn't been seen as a consolidated unit until around the 1990s, and we'll talk a little bit more about that later. After this initial period, the Treaties of Rome, the Treaty of Paris, there was a kind of like initial enthusiasm for the European project of integration had kind of passed a little bit. There was a greater concern with prosperity. War at this point was 12 years away, and it was becoming a more a thing of the past, and so it was less concern with preventing war and much more focus on prosperity. And we find two competing visions emerge in the future history of integration. I mean, really these visions were there, I think, from the very beginning, but they become much clearer to the eye, I think, after the Treaties of Rome. And this was the visions of supranationalism and intergovernmentalism. So just to talk a little bit about supranationalism, the essential idea of this was to stay true to the founding vision of Churchill, Monet, and Schuman, and to move towards an ever closer union. And a specific method has been, not necessarily, but generally associated with supranationalism. It's been called the Monet method, or it's also been called neo-functionalism. And the idea is not to take grand integration steps like the defense community, politically salient things like this. The idea was to pursue a kind of a functionalist logic, which is a long-term, step-by-step strategy whereby you try to increase the importance and the powers of the European institutions by gradually increasing the competences out of arguments of greater efficiency, arguments out of necessity. And so, we can take some examples. So you have a common market, you have free movement of people and goods, and this leads then to opportunities, at least economic opportunities, but it also leads to opportunities for international crime, it leads to opportunities for illegal immigration. And this then leads to an argument, well, we should perhaps begin to coordinate on international policing. We should cooperate on international border control. And this has gradually developed into institutions like Frontex, which is the European Border Control Agency, Europol, which is the European International Police Agency. Then another more familiar example might be, so again, you start with the common market, then increases trade between countries, but fluctuating currency rates prevents a barrier to trade. That then leads to an argument for, well, wouldn't it be good if we could fix exchange rates and give that power to the European institutions to coordinate that? And then say, well, if we're going to fix exchange rates, why not have just one common currency? And so this is the kind of the, yeah.
So was that a clear strategy or was that something that happened?
I think it was a clear strategy, especially, just, I mean, it's called the Monet method very often, after Jean Monnet, yeah, exactly, because, he saw this, had this vision of this functionalist logic beforehand. It's also a theory of European integration called neo-functionalism, but I think it was, there is arguably a certain logic to it, that this is how things proceed anyway, but it's something that was consciously adopted by Monet and many of the civil servants, high-level civil servants that followed him. Exactly. Yeah, exactly. I mean, this was seen as a problem that Monet and others, they wanted to isolate these important things. They found them to be, the international cooperation, to be too important to be subject to national, to the whims of national politics. So this was, I think, you're right, a kind of a conscious strategy. And because of this, it's actually become known also as integration by stealth. So integration by, without much public debate, without much citizen awareness, and just kind of, basically another word for it might be just creeping competences. So famous figures, like I mentioned Jean Monnet, Jacques Delors, they were both presidents of the European Commission, high-level civil servants. Mario Draghi is arguably another supranationalist proceeding in this way. He's the current head of the European Central Bank, and in the European crisis has been gradually extending some powers of the bank, which have just this week been challenged by the German Constitutional Court as going beyond its treaty mandate. But counter to supranationalists, we have intergovernmentalists. And this is a different vision for Europe, which rejects powerful European institutions. It much more sees the EU or the European institutions as there to facilitate coordinated cooperation between the member states, and that real power should always really remain with the member states. And we have famous figures like Charles de Gaulle, Margaret Thatcher, David Cameron. Well, we'll see if he makes a difference in the near future. But these have all tried to curtail supranationalist ambitions. Now, this kind of supranationalist intergovernmental kind of distinction—it's a little bit artificial, but I think it's not everybody is at one extreme or the other. But I think it's a very useful framework to understand how the treaty-making process happens. That each treaty has and it tends to have some kind of increase in supranational competences, supranational powers, but it also has some kind of counterbalance from the intergovernmental side, some security for the member states, some additional powers may be given to the member states. Okay, so this leads us to the next period, which is the gradualist period, I would call it. It's not as exciting as the launch period. It's not as exciting as the last 20 years of European integration, but there are certain events that took place within these 30 years, important events that we shouldn't skip over. So I'm just gonna give you as quick as possible some of the main highlights through this 30 period where the functionalist logic was most evident. So first of all, 1961, we had Denmark, UK, and Ireland apply for membership. Denmark and Ireland applied mainly because they were so economically attached to the UK. The UK were economically interested in becoming a member of the communities, but they were also motivated, I think, to check the increasing French ambitions for having dominance in Europe. And that's precisely for this reason that Charles de Gaulle, who really did have these big ambitions for France, that he vetoed the application of these countries. He very much saw the UK as a Trojan horse for US influence in the communities. That would undermine French influence. Then in 1962, we had the Assembly of the European Economic Community rename itself as the European Parliament. This might seem like a fairly innocuous move, but it made clear what the aspirations of this institution were. It wanted to gradually develop itself into a full-blown, no-fooling representative parliament. And it gradually worked on this very successfully over the course of the next 40 years. 1963 and 1964, the Court of Justice played a huge role in European integration with two landmark rulings. 1963, you had a ruling that established a doctrine of direct effect, which said that European legislation didn't apply to European citizens vicariously through the member states. European legislation applied directly to citizens. So this really is marked out the European institutions as something very different from other international organizations, because there was a direct relationship between the union legislation and the citizens. Supremacy in 1964, the doctrine of supremacy, this said that European legislation is supreme over national legislation in cases of conflict. So, I mean, and this I think might seem natural enough because it can be very difficult, obviously, to have a coordinated system of cooperation when one member state is following its own national laws against the agreed laws of the higher level, and another member state is following its own rules. You need to have some coordination, and this is almost a logical requirement. Yeah.
What about the German Constitutional Court? Did they agree with the supremacy doctrine?
No, and I was going to talk a little bit about that later in the concerns with the Lisbon Treaty, the Constitutional Court in Germany, but in other constitutional courts too, Italy have been very vocal. They refuse to formally accept the supremacy of European law, and this is why it's never made it into the treaties, despite best efforts. It's there in the Lisbon Treaty as an annex by the chief legal secretary of the European Union, who has a line saying, by the way, everybody, supremacy really does rule the day, just to let you know, even though it won't be formally stated in the treaties. So there is hostility to this idea from the courts, you're absolutely right. So then 1965 in Brussels, we had a very boring, very administrative treaty, but an extremely important treaty because it brought together the three different communities, coal and steel, the economic community, and Euratom, all within one institutional framework. So this was played a big role in kind of consolidating the European institutions and the European institutions into one institutional framework. In 1970, there was the European Political Cooperation, which was this kind of an informal organization operating outside the treaties, where member states, heads of member state met to discuss, have some kind of, you know, semblance of a foreign policy, and coordinate their activities in that regard. And this was the precursor to what would eventually become the Common Foreign and Security Policy. In 1973, the political landscape had changed. De Gaulle has gone from office. Member states see the economic potential of a wider market, and Denmark, Ireland, and the UK are allowed to join. 1974, the European Council is set up. This is again composed of heads of member states and governments, and it's an informal organization, again operating outside the treaties, and their role is to investigate new areas for integration, to deal with any major problems that can't be dealt with elsewhere. And this, as we'll see later on, will become a very important institution formally recognized in the treaties. 1976 is another important date, where there was the act concerning the election of the representatives of the assembly by direct universal suffrage. So more simply, turning the assembly, which was previously just a monitoring body, into something much more like a national parliament at the European level. And the first elections to the national parliament, or to the European Parliament, were in 1979, and have been held every 5 years since then. And if you do the math on that, you'll know we're in an election year, specifically in May. I think it's the 22nd of May it begins. There's elections, and these are going to be interesting elections. And we'll talk a little bit more about them later too. 1979, European Monetary System is set up. Mentioned this a little earlier. The idea was to introduce currency stability into the Union by fixing exchange rates within a limited band of about 2.5% fluctuation. And this was going to be a precursor to the common currency, which is now the Euro. 1981, Greece joined. 1986, Spain and Portugal, they joined. And it was what was interesting to note about these cases is that, you know, all three countries had in the 70s just emerged from dictatorships, and there was a relatively long waiting period for these countries to be allowed to join. And the idea was is that they had to demonstrate their commitments to democratic principles, and this was an interesting development because it really demonstrated that commitment to democracy was going to be a prerequisite for future admissions to the European Union. So that was an important historical statement. Okay, so that's the kind of the gradualist period, as I've called it, the gradualist period anyway. Next we go from 1986 to the present, which is the relaunch of the original project and the politicization of the European Union. So it was basically in the 1980s, there was a series of events and a set of circumstances that led to about 20 years of treaty reform that was going to turn Europe into something much more than just this unique example of economic integration on an international level. So Jacques Delors was one of the individuals who painted this kind of vision for the future of Europe. He wanted to, at least temporarily, depart from gradualism and take what he called a kind of a quantum leap in integration. And he thought that the quantum leap was necessary, but he thought that the necessity of moving forward should be done in the spirit of the original founders. So let's get back, he thought, to building the federal European Union. So one of the reasons for the necessity was that progress had stalled on the common market. Effectively, member states in the Council of Ministers were regularly using their veto, holding on to national legislation to block European legislation. So it was kind of, you know, member states were kind of pandering to their own domestic powerful lobby groups and vetoing any European legislation that would potentially threaten those sectors of their society. And this led to a big logjam in legislation, and the European and the common market became difficult to complete. So a big innovation of the Single European Act was that it expanded kinds of supermajoritarian voting in across many policy areas, which allowed, only instead of one member state blocking legislation, it typically required two or three member states. So it became much easier to pass things through and complete the common market. Other important measures of the Single European Act is that it formally incorporated the European Monetary System and the European Political Cooperation, which became known then as the Common Foreign and Security Policy. It also expanded competences in environmental and social policy, to name a few. And these treaties are huge documents, hundreds of pages. And I'm just kind of very much giving, a couple of the highlights. I mean, each treaty did a huge amount of things to change the institutional framework and the way the EU works. But these are so just keep that in mind when I'm going through these kind of bullet points parts. So one thing I haven't mentioned is that unanimous agreement between the member states is required to ratify a treaty. So usually the process is member states meet, draw up a treaty, and in order for the treaty to pass, it has to go through all the national parliaments, and then the parliaments must ratify the treaty. Denmark and Ireland, at the behest of their constitutional courts, were the first member states to hold a referendum on a treaty. In each case, there was no problems whatsoever. The Single European Act passed by clear majorities. But we'll see as we go on, treaties were going to become a bit of a problem for the integration process. Okay, so 1992 we had, which I think is clearly the most important modern treaty, took the biggest integration steps, and this is the quantum leap that Delors was really talking about in integration. And the reasons for it were primarily because the Single European Act had been such a great success. I mean, by the time the 90s completed, or by the time the 1990s hit, the common market was well on its way to completion. The logjam in legislation had become free, legislation was being passed, and there was a general sense that of positivity towards the European project and a willingness to explore new possibilities for integration. There was also the fall of the Berlin Wall, which created a whole new set of political developments that it was widely agreed Europe would need to come up with some kind of coordinated response to this. You had the reunification of Germany, and you also had potential massive instability on Europe's, on the member states' borders in post-communist countries. So this led to the major, to the Maastricht Treaty, and the major steps were a timetable going over about eight years, plan for a European Monetary Union, complete with a common currency and a European Central Bank. Then it was also strengthening in cooperation in common foreign and security policy and justice and home affairs. There was the creation of European citizenship. So no longer, so if you were a citizen of a member state, it meant that you were also now a citizen of the European Union. There was also an expansion of competences in areas like industrial policy, consumer protection, education, youth, culture, and a whole list of other competences. Now, all of this was seen as, like I said, very big steps, and further was seen that, some kind of legitimation or additional democratic legitimacy was required at the European level to help somehow justify this. And so this led to a big argument for co-decision being granted to the European Parliament. So the European Parliament became much less now that of a monitoring body and much more of a co-legislator in the European Union. So henceforward, not in all areas, but in many areas, to pass legislation at the European level, it had to go through the European Parliament in addition to the other institutions. And it, just like there were concerns for legitimacy, there were also concerns for national sovereignty. This was seen as, you know, ceding power, ceding monetary policy power, and ceding other powers potentially to do with foreign policy. And so this kind of strange pillar structure was introduced. In the first pillar, you had, it was the communities. So you had the coal and steel community, Euratom, European Economic Community, and basically the European institutions would take care of legislation for all those communities. Then you had the second pillar, which was a much more of an intergovernmental pillar, and that was composed of the common foreign and security policy, which was in the control of the member states only through the Council of Ministers. Then pillar three was justice and home affairs, which is again an intergovernmental pillar with its own rules, governed by the member, by interactions between the member states and the Council of Ministers. And so this led to a very complex structure, a lot of institutions, a lot of pillars, a lot of communities, and decided, well, we need to give some semblance of coherence to this kind of Leviathan, so they called it the European Union. And this is why the Maastricht Treaty is also called the Treaty on European Union. There were, in political terms, there were referendums in Denmark, France, and Ireland. It failed in Denmark primarily because there were concerns about this new European citizenship discourse, and there was also concerns about monetary union. And Denmark managed to negotiate an opt-out for monetary union, and this led to a second referendum in which the treaty eventually passed. Okay, so in 1995, we had Australia, Finland, and Sweden join. This is what was later on referred to as the EU 15, so we had 15 member states now, and they're grouped together because they generally have the similar kind of economic, social, and democratic credentials, in contrast to later member states who would join. And many of these future members were post-communist countries who had very different socioeconomic and political backgrounds to the original 15 member states. So the Treaty of Amsterdam then was called to, was seen as necessary to prepare for enlargement. You know, when you're going to have a whole influx of member states coming in, you're going to have to change the composition of the institutions, the decision-making procedures, the voting rules, etc. And that was the main task of Amsterdam. It obviously, like I said, these are huge documents. Amsterdam Treaty did a lot of things, but it was criticized widely. First of all, it was deemed to have failed to adequately prepare for enlargement. It didn't make these the rules clear. It didn't deal with some of the institutional problems that would arise from enlargement. There was also a complaint that the legal system was becoming far too complex. This was just another huge document thrown on top of all the other documents with the pillar structure, the communities. It was all getting very cumbersome. It was also seen that not enough was done in the Maastricht Treaty to deal with legitimacy problems, and Amsterdam didn't really help very much in improving the democratic legitimacy of the EU. So this led in 2001 to the Nice Treaty, and that was supposed to address the problems that were remaining from the Amsterdam Treaty. It is generally seen as being quite successful in preparing for enlargement, in reforming the institutions to prepare for enlargement. But you know, there was a lot of confusion over the competences of the European Union versus the member states. There was confusion over the jurisdiction of the Court of Justice in the different communities and in the different pillars. And you know, there was just a general frustration emerged after the Nice Treaty, which led to calls for a fundamental rethink of the whole EU legislative framework. And before we move on to that, it's worth noting that there were, again, more referendums, Denmark and Ireland once again. The treaty failed in Ireland, but concessions were made on grounds of, on concerning Irish neutrality. There was a worry that Irish neutrality was going to be threatened by this common foreign security policy. So there was negotiations would allow Ireland to opt out of that area of the treaty. And it passed it on the second attempt. Okay, so this led to a treaty, what was called a treaty establishing a constitution for Europe in 2004. And we see, you'll get the meaning of this image later on. So in preparing treaties, intergovernmental congresses, what were called intergovernmental congresses, were the norm. It's when member states, heads of member states and governments come together behind closed doors to hammer out over the course of several months or several years an agreed text, which they then present to their parliaments. But since they wanted to, the idea was to rethink the EU, they decided they would have a new strategy for coming up with the treaty text. And the new format was called the European Convention. It was open to the public, more than 200 members, some of them representatives from governments, some of them representatives from European institutions, and then there were representatives from national parliaments as well. And their task, like I said, was to prepare a new text that would serve as the new legal framework for the European Union. So what did the constitutional treaty do? First thing is that it replaced all existing treaties with one text. So those 2,800 pages of text composing all the previous treaties were going to be gone and replaced by this one simpler, thinner document. It was to abolish the pillar structure. It was to codify Court of Justice rulings of supremacy and direct effect and other rulings. And it was also to introduce a European flag and an anthem. Other measures were to give the EU one legal personality. Before, you had the legal personality of the European Economic Community and the European Union. It became very confusing in international trade relations and international negotiations outside of the European Union. So one legal personality was given. It spelled out what exactly the European Union competences were, because there had been a lot of a lack of clarity as to what these were from previous treaties. It also codified a principle of subsidiarity, which said that all decision making should happen at the lowest possible level, so that the EU couldn't be justified in making legislation on just about anything. It had to subscribe to this principle of subsidiarity. It also codified the right of withdrawal, so member states could now, it was very clear that they could withdraw at any time from the Union. It made legislation easier to pass by expanding majoritarian forms of decisions across a wider range of policy areas. It increased the power of the European Parliament by really making it almost on a par, again, with the Council of Ministers in legislative terms. So it did have the power of co-decision from the Maastricht Treaty, but now this was really brought to full effect on almost all levels of policy. It also made the European Council, which we discussed a little earlier, as an official institution. And it created two new very powerful positions, the President of the European Council and the High Representative for Foreign Affairs and Security Policy. It introduced citizens' initiatives, which gave citizens the right to propose legislation to the European Commission so long as 1 million signatures could be collected. And it also introduced a Charter of Fundamental Rights, which would apply within the competences of the EU and have equal legal value to the treaties. Okay, so, and again, it did many more things than this, but these are the things that are usually most highlighted. So these were very clearly significant steps, deeper integration, etc. But you know, when you compare it with something like the Maastricht Treaty, which was establishing a currency union and European citizenship, it was relatively modest. It was always going to be a very kind of controversial treaty. Euroscepticism was on the rise. There was more attention being played to the movements of Europe. You know, there had been so many treaties made over the course of 10, 15 years that people were really beginning to pay attention. Things weren't helped by the European Convention, in particular its convention leader, former French President Giscard d'Estaing. He was referring to the convention as Europe's Philadelphia moment, as if it was somehow comparable to the founding of the United States. He and others were responsible for calling the treaty the a constitutional treaty. So, you know, all of a sudden, citizens were thinking to themselves, they didn't know very much about the European Union. Now, all of a sudden, they're being told they have a constitution, a supranational constitution on top of their national one. So, this led to a lot of high degree of politicization, and 10 countries decided to opt for referendums on this. The treaties were a success in Spain and Luxembourg, but it failed in France and Netherlands, and it was looking very likely to fail, almost certain to fail in the UK, and many other states were in doubt. So at this point, the whole thing was called off. Constitution treaty was considered dead in the water. This led to a period of reflection of about a year or so, and a new treaty was proposed in 2007. Those who were paying attention saw that this was very similar to the constitutional treaty, but it lacked the constitutional language. So if we go back a little bit here, basically 1 to 4 were dropped. Everything else I've talked about, these the major innovations, were pretty much maintained in the Lisbon Treaty. So so what was dropped, first of all, all the other treaties remained in effect. So the Lisbon Treaty was just another treaty on top of all the other treaties. There was no single text. The pillar structure was technically abolished, but it's part of its remnants where it still remains. So you had Justice and Home Affairs, which was brought under the rubric of the European institutions, but the common foreign and security policy still remains very much within the grasp of the member states and was isolated from the Europeans. The other European institutions. There was no codification of the rulings of direct effect and supremacy. As you mentioned, the German Constitutional Court and other constitutional courts were big, were not fans of this at all. And then, of course, there were no flags or anthems to be codified in the Lisbon Treaty. Still, the Lisbon Treaty was extremely controversial. It wasn't clear whether or not it was really different to the constitutional treaty. Euroskeptics took big advantage of this, and you know, there was a huge amount of pressure on leaders to have another referendum in a lot of the member states. And the leaders managed to withstand this, you know, claiming, but really kind of playing down what the Lisbon Treaty was. And it was only Ireland who was constitutionally mandated to have a referendum. The referendum was rejected, or the treaty was rejected by referendum in Ireland. Several potential reasons for this, but one of the concessions that the government managed to negotiate had to do with the European Commission. So usually each commission, or the European Commission has one member for each member state. What the Lisbon Treaty tried to do was reduce the number of commissioners so that during every term, not every member state would have a commissioner. This was a big objection. Ireland had a big objection to this and was granted this concession that the European Commission would remain one member, one commissioner per member state. So once these and other concessions were made, the treaty can pass convincingly on the second attempt. Okay, so just to talk a little bit about the enlargements that took place between 2004 and the present. We had 10 countries in 2004, with Hungary and Poland being the most significant in terms of population size. 2007, Bulgaria and Romania joined, and then just about 9 months ago, Croatia joined. And this gave Europe a total of 28 countries and 23 officially recognized languages. Criticisms of this were that this was too many countries all at once. It was going to disrupt the functioning of the Union. That it was too quick for the member states involved. I mean, they were, like I say, they were post-communist countries. It was argued that they hadn't sufficiently consolidated themselves enough to warrant joining. And it was also considered that once they did join, it would make the union too diverse, which would have all sorts of problems for policy later on. But the big rationale for these countries to join the EU was to help promote stability in Eastern Europe and the Balkans, and also to prevent Eastern Europe from falling back within the realm of Russian politics and policy. And then we have a few more applicants which are waiting to join the EU. Turkey is obviously the most controversial of those. Whether or not that will happen is yet to be seen. But the other candidates are quite uncontroversial and are likely to join in the near future. So, well, shouldn't finish before saying a little bit about the euro crisis. In 2002, the euro finally came into circulation. 18 out of 28 member states today have it. Denmark and UK have negotiated an exemption in the past, and there are other member states who are pending and others who are very reluctant to join. 2008 financial crisis hit Eurozone countries hard, just like many other countries in the world, but it particularly, in the context of the Eurozone, hit Portugal, Ireland, Spain, Italy, and Greece particularly hard. These countries found themselves in a sovereign debt crisis. Essentially, they either the governments had borrowed too much to support the public finances, or else the national governments had taken on banking debt into their own sovereign debt. So this led to some of these countries, particularly Portugal, Ireland, Spain, and Greece, engaging in bailout programs administered by the European Commission, the European Central Bank, and the International Monetary Fund. So during this period, the EU demonstrated far-reaching powers. It controls the bailout programs, like I said, and was perceived as enforcing a kind of a policy of austerity on the member states who had agreed to the loan packages. So in other words, in exchange for being bailed out with these loans, the member states in question had to cut social spending dramatically and reform their tax systems and make various fiscal changes to their government as conditions in terms of the bailout. There was also a development of new financial instruments and policies that were perhaps not seen as within the remit of the central bank and other institutions. And this has all led to a major increase in Euroscepticism, especially across those member states in which there was a bailout program. There was a rise of nationalism in many member states. Sometimes this led to a rise of fascist parties, especially in Greece. We had a party gaining many seats in the national parliament, Golden Dawn it was called. So with this kind of increase in Euroscepticism, it's going to make these European elections to the parliament coming up in May very interesting. It could really shift the balance of actors within the parliament towards a more skeptical kind of parliament. And then on top of all this, or partly because of this, you have David Cameron calling for a new treaty and a new vision of Europe. So I'll stop there. Anyway, that's kind of the whistle-stop tour, according to me, of European integration. We can open it up for first of all, if you want to have a discussion about anything that was raised in the presentation, and then maybe we can talk a little bit about the David Cameron speech. Can I just actually have a show of hands as to who has read the Cameron speech? So, okay, a couple of these. Okay, so that's fine. I'll give a little presentation of it so everyone's up to speed. So if there's any questions or anything, feel free. No, this is a yeah, this is a kind of a different court that is it's related to the European Union, and it obviously has jurisdiction there. But the supremacy and direct effect, as far as I'm aware, doesn't apply. Okay. Yeah. Certainly. Yeah.
This idea of bringing the countries in, Eastern European countries, so they don't fall back into some kind of the Russian sphere of influence. What about the situation now where we have the Eastern Partnership being challenged by Russia?
Anybody else have thoughts on this? Well, in terms of getting, in terms of getting more countries into the Eastern Partnership, how does? Sorry, do you want to restate the question? Sphere of influence, yeah.
That was one of the reasons. And now we have the same situation with the Ukraine, Moldova, and Georgia, where there's a tension between Russia and the European Union regarding which countries should come into our lean towards Europe, and which countries should be in the Russian sphere of influence.
Yeah, this is I have no idea. I mean, especially it's so volatile at the minute in Ukraine. I mean, and obviously I think whether or not how Georgia and Moldova are going to feel about the EU and about Russia's will in large part depend on the outcome of what happens in Ukraine. It seems like Ukraine's the battleground now. Yeah, I mean, it definitely it has similar ambitions. I mean, it's very much taking the lessons of European integration seriously and trying to forge some kind of counterpart. I think the difference is that there seems to be at least the European Union is founded a little bit more on you might say principles of equality. Between the member states, where it seems to be very much this kind of Russian Federation seems to be much more dominated from Moscow, which I think would be a big difference and maybe a concern, especially for these smaller countries like Georgia. I mean, they might consider themselves having a faring better in terms of how well their voices are heard in the European Union. This is a
Western Europe is coming from a better place.
Yeah, that's definitely a valid criticism, I think, and I think you have, people like Ulrich Beck and others talking about, well, they see Europe as an empire, and very much just a new form of oppression in the guise of human rights and prosperity and these things, when in fact it's prosperity for just the European Union. This is debatable too. I mean, the European Union has various kind of attempts to create this kind of system, this kind of regional system in places like Africa, the idea being that, well, it is a neoliberal market ideology, I think. You know, it's trying to saying that, well, no, if Africa can get their markets together and can then become a stronger trading partner with Europe, then it will be better for Africa too. So it is a way of trying to export this model. The Union officials would certainly believe that they're trying to export the model for the good of all. But it is open to this kind of criticism, most certainly. And then you were talking about the difference between political and economic. Okay. Yeah. No, I think you're right as well, and economics has always been one of the key factors. And I mean, business, I haven't really talked about business and lobbying and such, but business has been there from the very beginning. Lobbying national governments, and then lobbying the institutions once they existed. So I think it's always been, certainly there's been ideological elements there, I think, that have played a role in driving things forward, but none of it's possible without the economics, I don't believe. Collaborals that you Yeah, okay. Yeah, no, and you're exactly right. I mean, and these were these kind of criteria were set forward, I mean, before the enlargement, in the Copenhagen criteria, there was a set of criteria and a very definitive process by which accession was to happen. There was, I think there's eight chapters, am I right in saying that? Eight chapters were, and each chapter has a set of criteria that a country has to meet before it can move on to the next chapter of negotiations. And then when all chapters are complete, eligibility is possible. So it has become a very intensive process for new member countries to proceed. I don't know, actually. I don't know the answer to that question. I mean, I think there tends to be I'm kind of thinking of Switzerland a little bit. It's probably, I think it largely is the same for most of the countries, but it tends to be, it tends to be specific agreements between, say, I mean, it's very interesting in Switzerland now because they have had a referendum which says we're going to have quotas on the number of immigrants from the European Union that can come into the country. But there are all of these specific agreements between the EU and Switzerland that this referendum would completely violate. So it's much more, I think, the EU having specific contracts to with these other nations individually rather than the whole, but it would, all those contracts would be consistent obviously with the European Constitution. So I don't know the certain answer, but my guess is that this is, it works the same for
I just know that in 2007 the association was being constructed in terms of other member states could apply for association. This was very much the discussion. I was just wondering if there
any developments?
Definitions.
Okay.
Just to clarify, following that, with the association agreements, is there, it's my understanding there is no formal link to enlargement, but promise of beginning
no.
the process of joining.
Yeah. Yeah, that's exactly right. Yeah. Except Greenland. Absolutely. Yeah, well, this brings us very nicely into talking about David Cameron's speech as well, because I mean, one of, if you look at the Scottish Manifesto for independence, one big thing it says is that we are Scottish, we are part of Europe. We are firmly want to be part of the European Union. If we stay in the UK, Westminster, led by the Tory, by the Conservative government, may take us out of the European Union. Scotland does not want that. So this has actually become a big rhetorical the fact that the UK may leave the European Union, this has become a big rhetorical benefit for Scotland. Now, in recent times, there's been a few strange interactions between the European Union officials and Scottish ministers. Like Barroso has recently said that it would be, who's the president of the Commission, has recently said that it would be extremely difficult for Scotland to join the European Union if it left Great Britain. and it's not clear why he didn't really give a reason, and this was reacted to immediately by the Scottish politicians saying, well, this is absolutely ridiculous. Why on earth would Scotland not be able to rejoin the European Union? Who would veto Scotland joining?
Spain.
Okay, yeah, maybe. So it's anyway, that's the discourse as it is at the moment. So it's definitely going to be interesting in that regard. But maybe if we have I think we have 5 minutes left, we'll talk a little bit about Cameron. I just wanted to give you a little bit of background. No, you're absolutely right. I mean, and this divergence is what has been used now as an argument for deeper political and economic integration. It's saying, no, we in order to prevent this drift, in order to help the southern states, particularly Greece, to recover, we need a whole new host of financial instruments, greater powers to the European Central Bank, and you know, there are all of these, you know, the stability mechanisms being set up, basically insurance policies for the entire European Union that member states will pay into, so that if there's a future crisis, there can be some kind of claims on that. So, and you know, there's also new rules introduced in terms of budget deficits in the member states. I can't remember what the exact figure is now, but it's something like you can't be more than 3.5% or 5% greater than the budget. So there's all of these extra measures to try to curtail that reality that in fact they are becoming more economically diverse. So whether or not it's going to work is the whole issue now at the moment. No, and I mean, this is some are arguing that it's not necessarily the euro that biases things, or the European Union that biases things in favor of Germany, but it's much more so the common European currency that does this, because you know Germany's got this stronger economy, and you know, if the Deutschmark was back, it would be a very expensive currency, whereas the other countries whose economies aren't so strong, they would have a much weaker currency. So they're by standardizing with the euro, they're kind of lifting themselves up a level, whereas Germany are getting things for cheaper. So this is arguably seen as that, you know, that the real tip in the balance in favor of Germany has been since 2000, 2002 with the introduction of the euro. And what you say about, I mean, some countries wanting to leave, other countries wanting to join, it's worth noting that there is a general political positivity towards the EU in the sense that political elites, all governments, pretty much want to stay in or come into the EU. It's the citizen Euroscepticism that I think you're more referring to in terms of withdrawal, etc. So, yeah. But I think we probably ran out of time for this session, so maybe we can talk about David Cameron's thoughts during lunch or something. We'll come back in half hour, I think, to speak on European politics.
Cool.
Thanks. Welcome back, everyone. I mean, like I said, I think there's a fairly artificial distinction between something like European integration and European politics, but, you know, it's helpful to kind of put different things in different buckets, you know, and break up the talk a little bit. So I've given you a few images there of just some of the main personalities we see today in the European Union. Top left, we've got Manuel Barroso, who's the president of the European Commission. In the middle there's Herman Van Rompuy, former Belgian prime minister, who's the president of the European Council. Then we've got Martin Schulz, who's the president of the European Parliament. Mario Draghi in the bottom left is the head of the European Central Bank. And then we have Catherine Ashton, the High Representative for Foreign Affairs and Security Policy. And these are all rotating positions, obviously, and will be replaced at sometime in the near future by others. I just want to do three things in this part of the talk. I want to identify a little bit the EU competences to just give you a clear sense of what the EU is actually doing, what it's legislating on. Explain a little bit more the institutional framework, how the actors relate to one another, and then give you a bit of an outline of this democratic deficit debate, which, you know, this kind of debate's been going on since the 1970s, largely confined to academic circles, but by the 80s and 90s and to the present day, it's very much a concern of citizens and governments as well as academics. Okay, so first of all, we talk about the competences of the EU. There we've got the symbol of the euro outside the European Central Bank headquartered in Frankfurt, Germany. So there are three kinds of competences: exclusive, shared, and supporting. Exclusive competences are basically those competences in which only the EU has legislative authority. So these are things like customs and commercial policy. These relate to Europe's external relations. So, you know, it's for customs coming into the euro and into the European Union, and it's commercial policies relating to trade negotiations with other actors like China, the US, and others. Then you have rules necessary for the internal market, so things like competition law to prevent monopolies, things to do with tariffs, etc. Then you've got monetary policy for the Eurozone countries, and then you have fisheries, you know, things like quotas on certain kinds of fish, where you can fish the particular waters you can fish in, etc. Shared competences are competences shared between the European level and the member state level, so both levels can make legislation. There's a rule governing how shared competences are divided, and basically the rule is that member states can exercise their competences only to the points at which the EU has not exercised its competences. So there's a priority given here to the EU in so far as how far it wants to extend its competences in the area. So we have things here like the internal market, so rules that are not necessary for the functioning of the internal market are shared competences. Social policy, environment, so, you know, things like reducing emissions, improving energy efficiency, etc. Transport networks, improving the efficiency of transport across the Union, and energy policy. Then the supporting competences. The EU has no has no jurisdiction, legislative jurisdiction in supporting competences, but it can initiate programs and supporting and various other supporting measures at the request of the member states or at their own initiative, so long as the member states don't object. So it can help with health, industrial policy, culture, and a whole range of others. Okay, so that's the competences. Talk a little bit about the institutional framework. With the Lisbon Treaty, there were 7 official institutions of the European Union. I mean, there are obviously a lot of other institutions attached to it. There's many, many bodies, but these are the 7 core institutions. The Court of Auditors is just the institution that makes sure the finances of the other institutions are in order. European Central Bank is the one taking care of the monetary policy for Eurozone countries. Court of Justice of the European Union is there to settle disputes over the treaties. It's there to allow, corporations can take other corporations, citizens can take corporations, citizens can take other citizens under EU law to the Court of Justice to settle disputes. The Commission can take member states to the Court of Justice for failing to implement EU law. The member states can at the same time take the Commission for overstepping to the Court of Justice for overstepping its boundaries, etc. But what we want to focus on for this talk is the European Council, the Council of Ministers, the European Commission, and the European Parliament. These are some of the most salient institutions. So first we have the European Council, which, as I mentioned before, was informally established in 1974. It's composed of prime ministers, presidents, and it meets about 4 times a year in addition to emergency meetings, whenever they may be called. Has no legislative power whatsoever, but it has very important functions in that it sets the long-term agenda of the EU, so the medium to long-term agenda, what goals the Union as a whole wants to achieve. It's the arbiter of last resort for disputes that cannot be settled in the Council of Ministers. So if the ministerial level positions have a difficulty in solving a particular dispute, they go to the European Council and the dispute's resolved there. They make some of the most important appointments in the EU, which is president. They appoint their own president, who we saw as Herman Van Rompuy at the moment. They appoint the president of the European Commission, the High Representative for Foreign Affairs, and the entire board of directors of the European Central Bank. Now, like I said, the European Council has no legislative power. The legislative power at the European level is with the Commission, the Council of Ministers, and the Parliament. Commission is composed of 28 commissioners, one for every member state. So every member state gets to appoint a commissioner. But the crucial thing to note about this is that this does not make the commissioner a representative of the member state. Each commissioner must take an oath of independence to say that they will not take instruction from or act in the interest of a member state. Their mandate is to act for the member state and the citizens as a whole. So they represent the EU, not member states. But it's not just the commissioners that make up the commission, it's also the civil service of the EU. It has 40 directorate generals, which are basically departments, and 25,000 staff manning these departments. Most interesting thing about the commission that it has the sole power of legislative initiative. So if you want any kind of law to even begin, it all starts with the Commission. And it's supposed to use this legislative power to carry out the goals of the EU as outlined by the long-term and medium-term agenda of the European Council. The Commission is also supposed to administer the budget in achieving these goals. It's supposed to uphold the treaties, so, you know, like I said, they can take member states to court, to the European Court of Justice, if they fail to implement the treaties as per the agreed schedule. And the commissioners can also act as the external representatives of the EU. So in trade negotiations with other countries, the commissioner responsible for that area will often be representing the EU. So it's a pretty important, pretty powerful organization or institution. So next we have the Council of Ministers, and that acts as if it is one formation, one institution, but it's actually a multifaceted organ. It comes in 10 configurations, environments, fisheries, agriculture, various other manifestations. And the idea is that each member state sends to the Council of Ministers the relevant representative for each configuration. So when it comes to the environmental policy, it will be typically the environmental ministers from each member state that goes to that Council of Ministers meeting. But you know, most of the debates, most of the legislation is already really worked out beforehand by the Committee of Permanent Representatives. So each member state also has a permanent representative who maintains consistency between the 10 configurations of the Council of Ministers. And so, you know, it's all prepared by these permanent representatives, and then the ministers come and, you know, deal with the outstanding issues and put their rubber stamp on it. Another thing to note about the Council of Ministers is that it has a 6-month rotating presidency. So every 6 months, a new country takes up what's called the presidency of the European Union. It was Ireland a few months ago. Currently, it's Greece has the presidency. And, you know, they don't really... The benefit of holding this position is, you know, that you get to shape a little bit the agenda of the Council of Ministers within that period. But, you know, there's got to be, because there has to be some kind of consistency going from one to the other, the scope for maneuver is quite limited. So it's much more of a symbolic position than anything else, I think. Main functions are to co-legislate with the EU. No legislation can pass the European level without the say of the Council of Ministers. It also has sole jurisdiction over, or almost sole jurisdiction over, the common foreign and security policy. So that brings us to the European Parliament. That's composed of 750 members plus the president. And the seats are allocated by population size, where you have the maximum number of seats given to Germany, 96, and the minimum number given to Malta at just 6. And this, you know, of course, leads to a big kind of disproportionality in terms of the ratio between representatives and citizens. So Germany has one MEP for about every 800,000 citizens. Malta has one MEP for about every 90,000 citizens. So there's a big differential there. The European Parliament's main functions are to co-legislate with the Council of Ministers on almost all issues, excluding common foreign security policy, to approve the budget proposed by the Commission. They can also scrutinize the Commission. I mean, something like 20 to 25,000 questions every year are submitted to the Commission, to the European Commission, and civil servants have to answer these questions. They also can approve the selection of commissioners. And, you know, commissioners are typically suggested by the European Council, and then the Parliament can approve it. And the Parliament can also remove the Commission. It can't remove individual commissioners, but it can remove the Commission as a whole through a motion of censure for incompetence or corruption or other things. There's an interesting thing going on right now, actually, in that the European Parliament is trying to indirectly increase its powers at this next election. So typically, like I said, the European Council will propose the president of who is going to be the president of the European Commission. And, you know, the European Parliament can either veto that or accept it. But what the European Parliament are doing now is that each party, or nearly all of the parties, are proposing their own candidate before the election and saying that if our party gets a majority, or if our party wins the European election, we expect the European Council to nominate our guy. So it's a really kind of trying to give a pre-electoral candidate who can then take a mandate to the European Commission. And it's a very interesting and smart tactic, because it really, you know, if the European Council declined to follow this advice, it could really be seen as an anti-democratic move. So this is a development to watch out for. Okay, so it'd be also good to know a bit more about how the politics works in the European Parliament, because it's the most political institution at the European level. First thing to note is that citizens vote for candidates of national parties. They don't vote for candidates first and foremost of European party. So when you're voting, you go for a national candidate who is generally a member of a national party. But there are party federations, Euro parties, at the European level, where so national parties get together and try to advance common policy aims. But you know, one thing about the party federations is that they're not publicised at all. So most European citizens on the street will have no idea that there are party federations or what their names are. But interesting studies on voting patterns have shown that they're actually relatively cohesive, these federations. They are not as quite as cohesive on, as a typical nation state, in terms of parties in the typical nation state, but they have proven to be more cohesive actually than how Republicans and Democrats vote in the US together. So it's an interesting piece of research. Also the left-right cleavage loosely applies in the European Parliament. So you have the biggest party is the European People's Party, which is a kind of right-leaning party, the Party of European Socialists, which is a relatively left-leaning party, and then you've got the Alliance of Liberals and Democrats and the European Green Party, which are both centrist parties. You've got about six or seven more party federations, and some of these have brought about a second cleavage, a pro-Europe, Eurosceptic cleavage. So some of these parties are explicitly Eurosceptic. They say they either want out of the EU, or they want the reduction of the powers of the EU, or they want to legitimize the European institutions in some way or another. So that's another deep political cleavage in the European Parliament that's probably going to emerge all the more so after the next election. Okay, so I'm just going to take you very quickly through the legislative procedure. I think you all know the joke about laws and sausages. You know, nobody really wants to know how they're made. So, you know, in that spirit, I'll just keep this part very, very brief. So you've got the several different kinds of legislative procedures. The main one is the ordinary legislative procedure, which outside of the common foreign and security policy accounts for 95% of all EU legislation. So like I said, the Commission has legislative initiative. It proposes it proposes legislation. It then goes straight to the national parliaments. They have 8 weeks to check for subsidiarity. If they believe the principle of subsidiarity is violated in some way, two-thirds of the parliaments can get together and send the bill back to the Commission and say, no, this bill doesn't fly because the decision could be better taken at the member state level or at the local level. But you know, most of the time, this measure has been invoked. I don't think there has ever been a two-thirds majority of parliaments who have sent the bill back on the grounds of subsidiarity, but it's a possibility. Then the bill is sent to the European Parliament, who make their amendments, goes to the Council of Ministers, they accept, reject some of the amendments, send it back to the Parliament, and there's a little bit of a back and forth there of amendments. At any time, the European Commission can withdraw the bill if it doesn't like where the bill is going. This is rarely done, though it's considered a pretty undemocratic move, so it's only done in kind of extreme situations. If no agreement can be found after these various readings and backs and forths, a conciliation committee is set up, composed of individuals from the Council of Ministers and from the European Parliament. They propose a final text, and it's either accepted or rejected, and that's the end of the process. An interesting political fact to note about this kind of high consensus process. I mean, it is a very high consensus process. I mean, you need three institutions. European Parliament usually has to pass things by absolute majority. Council of Ministers usually has to pass things by a qualified majority. So I think the formula is typically 55% of the member states representing 65% of the European citizens. That's what you need to pass legislation in the Council of Ministers. So it's highly consensual. It's very difficult to get agreement on a bill, but well, that's true and false. I mean, when it comes to new legislation, it can actually be quite a fluent process, because almost all of the actors, almost all of them want legislation where there was none before. So they prefer something rather than nothing. But when it comes to reform, this is the real issue. Because in order to reform any piece of legislation, the preferences of pretty much all of the actors have to have changed in some way. And now that there's already so much European legislation, I mean, most of it is not creating new areas of legislation. Most of it these days, or a lot of it at least, is reform. So it's becoming an increasingly difficult process to try and get legislation passed. Okay, so that's gives you a sense, I think, of the institutions and the basic politics of the EU. I'm just going to outline a little bit the democratic deficit debate, which, I, as I said, is becoming important not just in academics but also in wider political life. So I would break, I mean, there's many ways of thinking about this. I would break it up into three parts. There's an institutional deficit, or rather there's arguments for an institutional deficit. There are arguments for problems with the public sphere. There are arguments with problems of perception and participation. So concerning the institutional deficit, the European Commission is by far and away the prime target. It's seen as having these far-reaching powers. It's the only institution that can really control the agenda of the EU with its power of legislative initiative, but it's not directly elected or accountable to citizens. And citizens not having any control of the agenda whatsoever is seen as profoundly anti-democratic, and the European Commission is a highly problematic entity from that perspective. European Parliament, despite being presented as the most democratic, the democratic savior of the EU, is also said to have a democratic deficit, and that's mainly because elections European elections are considered to be second order. So when you have a European election, like I said, it's run by national candidates and national parties, and these candidates typically won't be talking about European issues. They won't be saying, you know, talking about commercial policy or customs or any of these things. They will be usually talking about national issues, and it's on this basis that the members of the European Parliament get elected. So they get elected on national issues, not European issues. And often citizens use the European elections as a way to kind of get back at the government by voting in alternative parties to the governing party. So basically, the members of the European Parliament, because they're not elected on European issues, they lack any European mandate. So this is considered to be a significant deficit of the Parliament. Then you've got a deficit in the Council and the Council of Ministers. Problem is that it can be very difficult to hold ministers accountable in the national parliaments, because if your minister goes away, makes a decision with the Council of Ministers, the national parliament doesn't like that decision and says, this is a terrible decision to make, it's bad for our country, why did you do it? The minister says, sorry, I tried my best, I was outvoted. So there's a difficulty in holding the ministers for accounts in this regard. Another problem is that in neither of these institutions, in neither the European Council or the Council of Ministers, sure, they are made up of nationally elected politicians, but the national elections aren't run either on European issues. So when ministers and heads of state and governments go to make decisions in the European Council, Council of Ministers, they have no specifically European mandate. So then in terms of the public sphere, typically democracy is associated with a vibrant public sphere held together by a media structure. The EU has no overarching public sphere, has no overarching media structure. This makes it very difficult to monitor the institution successfully. It makes it difficult for citizens to engage in cross-national debate. I mean, it's much more difficult, it seems, for someone in Germany to be debating with someone in Italy, say, than it is for someone in Ohio to be debating with someone in New York. There's not that fluidity of communication. Another problem with the public sphere is that civil society tends to be typically very weak at the European level. So part of the reason for this is because of the high transnational, of the high costs in organizing a transnational civil society, and much more difficult to organize it in, on the EU stage than it is to organize it on the national stage. And this has led to business interests being far more successful in lobbying the EU institutions than civil society organizations. And you know, we have this sign up saying democracy, not corporatocracy, and this is the kind of criticism, this is a good way of summing up the criticism towards the lack of civil society. So then the final kind of deficits are more related to the issues of participation and perception. So we see from the graph there that, you know, participation in European elections started off from an all-time high in 1979 and went to an all-time low of 43% in 2009. And, you know, this could have something to do with enlargement as well. You know, some countries joining don't have as much of a democratic participation as the original members. There are various factors, but there's a general trend towards lower participation in European elections. There's also a sense in which citizens are disconnected from the European Parliament once they're elected. You know, there's very little, like, once the parliamentarians are elected, they go to Brussels, and there's very little contact after that between citizens and the members of the European Parliament. So there's a lack of participation in influencing their members of Parliament. And then there's a strong sense of distrust that has emerged, especially in the last decades. This is partly because of the distance of the European institutions, but it's also partly because I think, you know, there's been much more awareness of citizens of this strategy of integration by stealth. People very much feel that the EU has increasingly has kind of come up behind them without them really knowing about it. And all of a sudden it's there, it's big, and they don't know how it got there. They don't feel like they've validated it. So this is partly an explanation for this kind of sense of distrust to the European institutions, which has only increased since the European crisis, or since the Euro crisis. We have another side of the debate, which basically says, well, you know, either there is no democratic deficit or it's not really that bad. So there's one view that says, well, you know, most of the EU's work, it's pretty technical, it's pretty regulatory, you know, which there are no central banks on the national level that are democratized. Why do we need to be so worried about the European Central Bank not being democratized? There's, you know, empirical tests of this argument, trying to show, well, you know, in things like commercial policy, and actually a lot of what the EU does, there actually are winners and losers created. Things like commercial policy, environmental policy, social policy, these things create winners and losers and have redistributive effects. So there's kind of doubts cast over this argument that the EU's is really just a regulatory agency. Another argument says that, well, you know, what's really the big deal? I mean, citizens are represented, and often they're represented better at the European level than they are at the national level. European Council is composed of elected politicians, so is the European Parliament, so is the Council of Ministers. These are all elected. And then the Commission and the European Central Bank, they're not directly elected, but they are appointed by elected politicians. So there's just, it's just a straightforward argument. What's the big deal? The EU looks fairly democratic. Then there's others who would say a weak civil society is not really a problem. Most of what the EU has to do with is deregulating the common market. It has to do with increasing jobs, etc. And that it's only natural that businesses are the ones who should be lobbying at the European level, rather than civil society. Civil society, it would be nice to have more of it, but it really is, the role is really there for businesses. So that's the other side of the debate. There's a popular position kind of in between that, which, or at least it was a popular position, I think. And it said, okay, sure, there is a democratic deficit in the EU, we're willing to admit that. We can say in this regard that the EU lacks input legitimacy, so input being a synonym for democracy. But they say, but you know, the output legitimacy of the EU has been so good, everybody has benefited so much from the European Union that the output legitimacy of the EU more than makes up for the lack of input legitimacy. So this was a fairly popular position to hold for a time, and then of course you have something like the European crisis, which you know really undermines the good outputs that the EU were supposedly producing. And you know, you have youth unemployment in several Mediterranean countries above 50%. Things are certainly not getting better for many of the countries. And like you said before, there's no end in sight to the euro crisis. So this argument of outputs making up for bad inputs or lack of inputs doesn't hold any longer. And we can see, you know, just a change in the attitudes of how satisfied people are with the outputs of the EU, and pretty much in every case. I'm surprised to see Germany increasing by 2% there, but there are other polls that show it, that show German approval dramatically decreasing. But as you can see, there's a general shift of dissatisfaction with the outputs of the EU. Okay, so I mean, this is a, we've talked about the competences, the institutional framework, and the deficit, and yeah, we can open it up for general discussion now. And has anybody read the Nikolaidis piece, the democracy article? Yeah, sounds okay. So we can discuss that too. That's okay. It's okay. Just I have a summary here too. If we get around to discussing it, then we can. I think it's largely due to the perception of the EU in terms of its handling of the crisis. I mean, particularly in this kind of forcing bailout programs, well, at least perceived forcing these bailout programs. It's the EU has whether accurately or not been portrayed as a bit of a predator in the last several years, taking competences from and sovereignty from the member states, you know, for taking advantage in a way of their debt-stricken situation. So, and some of the smaller countries, so that wouldn't exactly explain Poland, but would certainly explain Czech Republics. They tend to be very sensitive to these over big arm grabs from the top. So I think this is this explains a large part, not all of it, but. Yeah.
One observation that I'm making is that, yes, these countries are a part of the European Union, but some of these countries don't adopt the euro. They're very important. And for example, Poland does not have the euro. And so, yes, they're part of the European Union, but it's kind of like an independent central bank. And, for example, the other is about Britain. That is, as well, law doesn't need to be euro, and yet it's much better than Europe. You know, the marginal is very important. So, it has to be very important for those who are not a member of the European Union, but a non member of the European Monetary Union.
And as well, I mean, that can certainly be a reason to answer your question further as well. I mean, an additional reason for this skepticism in these countries, because they're seeing themselves, well, actually, look at us. We didn't take these extra steps to your European integration, and we're doing better. So it can also be a reason for this extra disapproval. Slovakia.
And they were much better than Slovakia. Slovakia is in the European, they are not in the Euro. Czech is not to stay out. And they are happy. They have the Union, but they have their own currency.
Mm-hmm.
So, and they are much better than their system that's inside the Euro.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, yeah, no, all of this definitely contributes to general skepticism of the European project. Every time there's a big faltering, it attracts various skeptical sentiments all across Europe. And then and then there's increased skepticism. I know this poll here doesn't show it, but there tends to be increased skepticism in Germany as well, because they increasingly tend to see themselves as the ones who are paying for it all. So when there's a big problem, they're the main contributors to the central bank. They're the main contributors to various cohesion funds to help the member states out, and they really see that the European project is being advanced. Its failures and its successes are due to, in large part, to the German purse. So this is another reason for this. So sorry, I think you had. That's a really interesting question. Actually, I haven't seen anything specific. I'm almost certain that there would be something. Because typically younger people are much more in favor of the EU, but it is now younger people who are suffering the worst in the crisis. It's like I was saying, it's youth employment in Mediterranean countries is above 50%. It's not as bad statistics in the rest of Europe, but in other countries, I mean, the youth are definitely suffering the worst. And somewhere like Ireland, a lot of young people going to Australia, the US, right? So that would be really interesting. I want to look that up now. Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's what my
question
is.
Yeah, okay.
Countries that accepted the Euro don't have an option now to reject it. No.
Leaving the EU, you couldn't just leave the Eurozone.
Right. Yeah. By population. Yeah, exactly. Population. And it was, the current parliament is bigger than the next one will be. I think it's 766 seats now, but they wanted to shrink it down. This was part of the Lisbon Treaty, was to shrink the size of the parliament.
Shared
competence, yeah. Yeah, well, the scheme, when it was first launched, I think in the early 2000s, it completely failed. The market the carbon market was not very old when it completely collapsed. So the whole idea of a trading scheme has, I don't even think it's been driven too much at the UN level either. I mean, Europe wanted to be the first to have a successful trading scheme while the UN were still arguing over it, but it didn't work. And I mean, most of the policy stuff now is focused, the environmental policy is focusing on these goals that were set out a few years ago. It's called 20-20-20 by 2020. So 20% increase in reduce of renewables, 20% decrease in use of fossil fuels, and 20% increase in energy efficiency, all by 2020. These are the European goals, and there are various directives and regulations that the EU is passing to try and coordinate that all across member states. You know, things like regulating the emission standards of new motor vehicles and various things like this. So that's the, it's actually been a big part of European legislation for the last year. Like, they're very proactive when it comes to the whole climate, or they have been at least proactive when it comes to the climate change issue. And the goals seem to be, these 2020 goals seem to be relatively on target. They probably won't meet them, but they're relatively on target.
So, also with respect to nuclear policy, each individual country has control over energy policy. Germany is moving away from nuclear, and they're replacing that policy or that source of energy. So they're defeating their own purpose in terms of carbon emissions, by moving away from nuclear. Meanwhile, France has all these nuclear facilities on the German border, so what are they scared of?
Yeah.
Seems ironic.
No, you have a point. I didn't realize that they were reopening or opening new coal-fired power plants.
Yeah, they are.
Okay. I thought it was renewables.
They have to get a substitute. They decommissioned 8 power plants and nuclear power plants. So they need a substitute. It's not going to be wind and solar.
Right. No, I didn't realize that. I thought they were trying to replace with wind and solar, but okay. Yeah, this does seem self-defeating. Yeah. An increase in use of renewables.
Sorry.
An increase in the use of renewable energy. So more wind, more sun, more solar.
And just this idea of shared competency. How does that work? Is it the state can regulate, or member states regulates, as long as the EU does not act in the area?
Exactly.
Can the EU then begin to act if they have not in the past, or
they can begin to act if they have not in the past. I mean, and it's technically favored in terms of how much the EU wants to extend its competences. But in reality, they're not just going to start completely taking over environmental policy. There'll be a lot of pushback from the member states. So it's going to be always a negotiated thing. And it's very similar to the structure of centralization and decentralization in the US, you know, in terms of. Yeah. Yeah, but it's a similar kind of structural element to it.
Okay.
Yeah.
But EU environmental directives have to be followed by everyone.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, exactly. The in these areas of shared competences, I mean, once the EU makes the legislation, it is, it's supposed to be supreme. Yeah.
Their only goal is to solve these issues.
their only stated goal. Yeah, I mean,
you know, for Europe to have their unemployment at 4.4%, an increase, that's about a little
bit. Yeah. I mean, there's definitely an argument for this, but it, once again, it comes back to what the competences of the central bank, in fact, are, and the question is, we'll come back to a supranational intergovernmental debate where the supranationals are like, of course, yes, we want these competences in the central bank. We want the central bank to be able to tackle unemployment, but there's going to be pushback from that saying, we do not want a Federal Reserve in Europe. It will be seen as just more sovereignty being taken away from member states. So there's an argument coming from two sides for it. You know, it's perhaps even it may be a good efficiency argument that you're making, but it can also be it can sometimes. I mean, we were talking a little bit earlier about economics taking precedence over politics, but you know, sometimes it can be ideology taking precedence over efficiency measures like this.
And for example, the unemployment, which agency would be look at the European agency would look at the unemployment issue?
Which agency? Yeah, absolutely. I mean,
and they address many issues
about
the unemployment in Europe.
Yeah.
What agency do you think should take a look?
Well, I think it has all been going through the main legislative institutions. It's been going through Council of Ministers, the European Parliament, and the Commission have been passing legislation or trying to pass legislations of all kinds in order to tackle this. I mean, and you know, I'm not too familiar with the economics of all this, and I'm not too familiar with if there actually have been many specific agencies set up to tackle employment. But it's in the daily discourse of the Parliament and the Council of Ministers.
For one thing, the euro.
Sorry, say that again?
The exchange rate, your exchange rate, the dollar vis-a-vis other currencies, is that very, very high. And then a deep recession, and it does not justify the economy.
Mm-hmm.
With this high unemployment, thanks for the economics, one, they employ you. But they are fixing at a high exchange rate of the euro.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Not the high euro exchange rate, it does not matter.
Yeah.
One of the reasons we are bringing jobs to our export. Why? Because our dollar is much, much lower.
Mm-hmm.
So we are bringing jobs to our export. That's second. But Europe, that high euro is another currency. It's not helping their economy or their economy.
Yeah. And it's also problems to do with the move in Europe to a very much of a services kind of economy. I mean, I know the US has a strong service economy too, but it also has this this industrial base as well, like you talking about exports. I mean, it's only really Germany that is the big exporter of Europe. The rest of the countries are struggling to keep up in any way with that. So they're very much focused on services industries. So this is another problem in addition to all that. Go ahead. Sorry? I don't know actually who the representative is. It could easily be one of the commissioners. It's I doubt it's anyone from the European Council. Well, but it could be the president of the European Council. I don't know. Sorry. Okay. Yeah, I never thought to look into that. Yeah. more Google questions. Thanks for coming. Well, you
in the long term, if I can post, we see Asia growing at 4-5%, mm-hmm. and the United States 2-3%. Europe in the last 4-5 years almost 0%.
Mm-hmm. This is our good point. These are very good points, and I mean, these are the very objections that were ominously raised by those who are against the euro. I mean, there was a fairly big debate about the euro at the time, and it's interesting, you know, some of these videos now and some of these interviews resurface. And they're predicting these things, and the argument is generally, how can you have monetary union without fiscal union, without political union? You know, if you can't have some kind of coordination across all of these sectors, then the problems with monetary union will spill over into other areas, and because you don't have competences in those other areas, you won't be able to contain them. And these kind of arguments are becoming more and more persuasive, like you say. And then the question is, there's a little bit of a dichotomy coming forward. Is it more integration the solution, or less integration and get rid of the euro? That's the question that's not been directly answered, because nobody, because it has big consequences and it seems to be constantly being pushed down the road, and you know, we're still in this limbo position where the rest of the world seems to be recovering and Europe seems to be just tottering along. Everything else, yeah. No, you're right.
I think what fascinates me most about the conversation with regards to the European Union is that I'm enjoying listening to the various aspects of parts of Europe, even folks that are paying attention to Europe, or may not necessarily be European like that, but they are paying attention to Europe, and speaking about what community can look like, EU as a community, even if it's a community against other international communities, such as communities in Africa and the Middle East, but nonetheless, Europe as a community. This conversation is taking place during a time with this increased movements towards individualism, with neoliberalism and such. And I find that to be such an interesting, such a fascinating paradox of trying to find what community can look like while policies, especially in the US, are becoming even more individualistic, and international policies becoming even more individualistic, whether it was in the United States.
And that's a very good point, and I think the EU is interesting in that regard, because it plays into this a kind of neoliberal individualism, in the sense that it gives people this free market, this freedom of movement. You know, you don't have to stay in your country if you don't want to. You can just go move somewhere else if you don't like it. You can move into various. You have access to a greater labor market. So in a way, it's a community that attracts an individualism in a certain way. There's a whole range of stuff written on European identity and European community. And
you know. People are real clear about that.
Yeah. Yeah, we'll continue. Sounds good.